Hello, my name is Bill Real. I'm the heating plant manager. Welcome to the Dartmouth College heating plant. Realized that I needed to outreach a little bit and just get the word out what we do here, and it just helps to educate. It's really not just a heating plant, even though that's what we call it here because our main purpose is to provide steam, but in reality it's a cogeneration plant. Through cogeneration we make about 40% of the electricity that the campus uses. It's the oldest continuously operated cogeneration plant in the country. It's an old plant, 1898 is the original building, installed here to supply steam to campus for heat and hot water. They started generating DC electricity here in 1903. Plant's gone through a bunch of changes since 1898. It's really an energy plant, so we'll just talk about energy for a second. Energy in is the oil, the chemical energy, the oil, our energy in, burning that oil in a boiler, generating steam. Output of the boiler is now thermal energy. Thermal energy can either go to the turbines, which is the predominant path for all the steam, where we take some of that thermal energy, driving a generator, producing electrical energy, and then the exhaust from a turbine is still thermal energy, and that's what goes out to campus and does work. We burn number six oil here. Two big advantages: a lot of energy in a gallon of number six, and economically cheaper than all other fuel oils. This is an 8,000 gallon insulated tank truck right here. Cold winter week, we could get 20 to 25 trucks in. This time of year, we're getting like 10 trucks. Jay is one of the truck drivers we see a lot. He works for JP Noonan. Having worked here for 16 years and interfacing with truck drivers, it's one job I wouldn't want for all the tea in China. Jay got up at 11 o'clock last night, got to the terminal at 12:30, loaded his truck at the terminal in the middle of the night, drove here for 4 hours, unloaded, drove back across Vermont, loaded, and now it's 2:30 in the afternoon and he's back, and now he still has to drive back home. All right, walking into the boiler room. You're looking at the burner front on the boiler right there where Mike is. The gun is installed in the middle of the yellow flange right there. We actually use steam to atomize the number six oil. Number six oil is always a liquid. Comes always in as a liquid. All we do is keep heating it up till we get it to 240 degrees at the burner front to ensure complete combustion at the burner temperature. Uh-oh, we have a grumpy operator here. So we're in the boiler shack. Bob Arnold is our day shift boiler operator. We met Bob when he was working for a turbine repair company doing one of our 5-year annual inspections on our turbine. Bob was the lead man on that crew, traveled all through the Northeast, Mid-Atlantic states doing turbine repairs. He was local to New Hampshire. We got to know him over the month or two that he was working here. Obviously talking every day, good guy, good fit, been here ever since. And with his background in water treatment, you know, we do a lot of our boiler testing here, so we have a little lab over here where we test the chemistry on the boilers. Certainly one of Bob's strong points. A big part of keeping a boiler around for 50 years, like our 1966 boiler, is proper boiler water chemistry. We may boil off 1 to 2 million pounds of water every day. So any impurities in that water, there would be a lot, you know, you just cycle the boiler up. We're testing all the trips associated with the burner management shutdown of that boiler coming out of outage. There's 15 different things that will trip this boiler. High steam pressure, loss of atomizing, loss of control system, low water level on the boilers. So we run through this checklist and verify that all the trip logic is working, and we document this for insurance purposes, because if anything were to happen, you know, we want to have our I's dotted and our T's crossed that we're running a safe operation that's tested and up to boiler code. We're restarting an extra boiler for the 7 hours in the morning and then shutting it off when it's warm and sunny in the afternoon.
Gotcha.
So even though I say all of our process is 100% automatic, you can see all the manual valves in the plant that would have to be opened and closed by operators. Anything with a handrail like that would be a manual valve. So it's more than just pushing a button to start a boiler. You got to open vents, drains, open outlet valves. And you got to know what every valve is. And there's thousands and thousands of valves in this plant.
Do you have a favorite boiler, or one that you like more than another?
I think our 1966 boiler has been probably the most reliable in the workhorse of this plant. I use the analogy like an old car and a new car. Yeah. You know, an old boiler is made with a lot of metal, the wall thickness, the casing, the construction materials. They weren't sparing expenses to make a very rugged boiler. So this is going into our operating plant. The brick wall on that side, you can see the high pressure steam piping coming through high. The rectangular box that says dresser on it. That's the turbine, 13 stages of turbine blading, reducing the pressure in that steam, taking energy out of that steam through a gear reducer, driving a generator. Very loud in that room. The turbine is spinning at 6,000 RPM. Figured I'd bring you back to the base of the stack. It's one of our best architectural features around here. You don't really see these old brick stacks anymore. This 1958 stack replaced the original 1898 stack. . 175 feet tall, halfway up, you see that platform, that's where we monitor opacity to measure of any smoke leaving the stack. Part of our permit requirements is not to discharge gas in excess of 20% opacity, so that's one of our more important instruments here. Well, when I got here in 1996, I started in February 95. Place wasn't in the greatest shape, and that wasn't a fault of the people. I think it was just the college wasn't making the capital investment to keep the plant with the times. When I got here, they made a commitment to spend some good money, upgrade the plant. It's kind of fortunate to be here when they were doing that. Very familiar with all the systems and equipment in this plant. Have installed the majority of it. There's only three people in this plant I haven't hired. The plant supervisor is Kevin Hammond, the maintenance lead man, and one boiler operator. Otherwise, everybody in here is a new hire. There's always two guys on watch in the heating plant. Terry is our day shift turbine operator. And then there's a boiler operator on the other end whose job is to operate the boilers and all the auxiliary equipment associated with the boilers. Terry's got oversight of the whole plant. He's the main decision maker if a decision has to be made. So he's looking at not only the generation, but obviously he's looking at the boilers and all the other subsystems in our plant. And then they'll work together to resolve any issues that might come up in the course of a day or whatever.
We have to understand how the plant works, how the systems function together, and how to put it when things aren't working, and when they go down, how to bring the plant back up safely and correctly, and put it back online. And that's really what we get paid to do.
The second smartest man in the plant, line two.
Frank Furman is one of the two high voltage electricians that support campus. We work with them a lot, being that we're a distributor. Frank was also U.S. Navy, does all the high voltage work for the campus. That's why we let Frank hang out here, because he's just a good all-around guy, right? He smiles too.
Did you tell him that we have to put up with an Army guy or Air Force?
Yeah, I mentioned he was in the Army. It had nothing to do with heating plants, but never a bad thing to be in the Army, I guess.
Thanks, appreciate that, Bill.
Scout sniper, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. All right, well.
Number one, it's official. The letter's out.
It's out? My letter? Your letter?
Article 1.
Respect? All right, we'll walk out back through. Thank you, Bob. Kevin Hammond, plant supervisor. He ain't doing anything either, even though he makes it think that he is. Lincoln is the main worker. Probably the smartest guy in the plant, best looking.
No, he's not talking about me.
Biggest muscles. Lincoln was in the Navy 4 years. BT or MM, Lincoln? MM. MM. So machinist, made in the Navy. Got out of the Navy, get some roofing in Florida. That's where he got his big muscles from. And then,
My favorite part of working here? Flexibility in the combat.
What's your least favorite part of working here? How about that? Yeah.
My least?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
We come in here real quick. This is really the heartbeat of our operation as far as the controls go. Mike is a very new hire, U.S. Navy. Rick, turn around. There he is. See how old he is?
Yeah, I'm old. Antique.
He tells us every day how old he is.
Oh, good
meme. Me too, if you can't tell from the accent. You can't slack off in this job. There's too much potential energy, and energy that could kill people, for people not to do their jobs properly. So that's not even like somebody that was unhappy in their job could do less in their job. I don't think you could find that in this type of environment, because if you don't do something up to standards, there's potential for somebody else to get hurt, and or equipment to fail and you to get hurt. So yeah, you have no choice but to do the job to the best of your ability in a safe and efficient manner. Because it's an energy plant. There's a lot of stuff here that could get you.